it says Swisser 127. He had a UFO or a rocket, something almost hit him in my airspace.
Military radar advises they are picking up an intermittent primary target behind you in trail.
Since the earliest years of manned flight, pilots and astronauts from around the world have encountered UFOs high in our skies and beyond.
This is Houston. Say again, 7.
Now, many of their dramatic cockpit recordings, film clips, and stories have been made available for the first time.
UFO? It's the Roswell crap again.
UFO reports that we get from professional pilots are considered among the very best because of their knowledge of the sky.
From never-before-released black box and control tower recordings, from commercial airline flights.
You still see traffic out there?
Hell yeah.
For the FAA, UFOs are real. They've been punishing pilots and covering up UFO reports for over 50 years.
To never-before-seen astronaut reports and secret recordings in outer space, as recently as 2005.
We have an unidentified flying object.
Many of NASA's top astronauts have already testified to seeing UFOs.
As astronauts and pilots around the world report an ever-increasing level of unusual activity in our skies.
Big bright light on the front and a greenish teal coming out of the back.
I tell you what, that is.
And the military is going to pitch anything flying tonight.
It was too fast to be an airplane.
Looks like a UFO.
Many wonder, do the skies belong to us or to them?
The report that was made last November 17th of a UFO spotted over Alaska attracted special attention. This sighting was made by an airline pilot with 29 years of experience.
The crew claims that while it was flying over Alaska last November, it was followed for 400 miles by strange white, yellow, and amber lights.
Of the thousands of reported pilot and astronaut encounters with UFOs around the world, few are more harrowing than the encounter on November 17, 1986, by Japanese Airlines Flight 1628, high above the remote Alaskan tundra.
Regarding airline cases in America, the GL is very interesting because you have multiple witnesses.
It was a cargo aircraft, and the pilots observed an object that seemed to be tracking along with their aircraft.
It involved an investigation by the FAA. This is an official government investigation. The sighting itself.
The events of that night were captured on tape.
Spinner 1628 heavy. Military radar advises they are picking up an intermittent primary target behind you in trail. In trail, I say again.
The Boeing 747 cargo jet is on a routine flight from Paris to Tokyo, cruising at 600 miles per hour at an altitude of 35,000 feet. It heads towards Anchorage, Alaska to refuel. Suddenly, at 5:11 p.m., Captain Kenju Terauchi, a pilot with 29 years flight experience, sees three large, fast-moving, unidentified objects 2,000 feet below them. The largest object is described by Captain Terauchi as resembling, quote, a shelled walnut. Captain Terauchi describes the main craft as being twice the size of an American aircraft carrier.
Co-pilot said it was as solid there as if you were seeing an oncoming jet with its lights on, except it wasn't an oncoming jet.
747 was nothing compared to this big flying saucer.
After several minutes of observing the UFO, the pilots realize the objects are now matching their speed, 600 miles per hour, tracking them. The captain reports that the objects begin, quote, making moves that are impossible for any man-made aircraft to perform. Then, without warning, two of the smaller craft suddenly rise and shoot directly in front of the pilot's window. The objects come so close to the airplane that Captain Terauchi says the intense glow makes his face feel warm.
All of a sudden they appear and they're traveling right in front of the aircraft. And they were sort of wobbling back and forth as they moved. They seemed to be only a thousand, maybe 2,000 feet in front of the aircraft and traveling at 600 and some miles an hour.
At that very moment, the radio link to Anchorage goes dead, leaving the aircraft flying blind. A horrifying catastrophe is seconds away, but the UFOs rise and veer left.
Just deviate from some object. Equestrating 240.
Spinner 1628 heavy. Deviation is approved as necessary for traffic.
It's quite a big. Like a whole nation.
Formation.
In his official FAA report, Captain Terauchi says, quote, we had to get away from that object.
Spinner 1628, sir, do you still have the traffic?
Disappears, Spinner 1628.
Spinner 1628, I understand you do not see the traffic any longer?
Okay.
Moments later, an urgent message comes in from Elmendorf Air Force Base. The unidentified object now appears on their radar.
Yeah, this 1-2 again. We have confirmed there is a flight size of 2 around your 1550 squawk. One primary return only.
Okay, where is he following him?
It looks like he is, yes.
Okay, stand by.
The phrase flight size of 2 indicates that JAL 1628 has uninvited guests with possible hostile intentions.
Spinner 1628 heavy. Military radar advises they are picking up an intermittent primary target behind you, in trail, I say again.
Immediately after this confirmation, the FAA requests that the Air Force scramble jets.
Do you have anybody to scramble up there, or do you want to do that?
Oh, we're going to talk to your liaison officer about that.
It's starting to concern that Japan Airlines, taking the 360 now, and still following.
Okay, we'll call the military desk on this.
Although the military desk took no action, JAL 1628 was able to land safely in Anchorage at 6:20 p.m. Extensive media coverage from around the world helped make this incident one of the most widely reported UFO cases in history. While the JAL case continues to inspire debate about the nature and intent of the objects that tracked the 747, to this day, the case remains a mystery.
The Japan Airlines 747 had a saucer go around it. The papers mysteriously disappeared from the FAA office.
January 30, 1987, only 2 months after the JAL report, a similar UFO event takes place in these same Alaskan skies, but this one involves the U.S. military. A U.S. Air Force KC-135 inbound from Elmendorf Air Base in Anchorage to Eielson Air Force Base southeast of Fairbanks reports a chilling UFO-related incident at 20,000 feet.
Yeah, it's showing traffic for us around 1 o'clock. Can't really tell the distance. CSD about still altitude.
Factor 29, negative. I have no traffic and you're 1 o'clock.
The pilot reports that the object is strikingly similar to the UFO reported by the JAL flight, a massive, disc-shaped, noiseless object larger than an aircraft carrier. Seconds later, Anchorage Air Traffic Control asks if the KC-135 still has the object in sight. The pilot replies yes, and says the object is now 40 feet from his aircraft. The recent incident involving JAL Flight 1628 even comes up in their cockpit recording.
Up there.
30 minutes later, the Anchorage control tower passes along a message from the regional FAA office.
Actor 29, the quality assurance staff at the Anchorage Center here requests you give them a call after you land at Eielson.
That is concerning the objects we're looking at.
Affirmative, sir.
I think pilots make especially good UFO witnesses. They know what's normal in the sky and what isn't. They've seen all different kinds of airplanes routinely. When a pilot reports a UFO, there's a better than average chance that that's what it was.
January 31st, 1987, less than 24 hours after the KC-135 encounter, yet another UFO-related incident occurs in the skies above Alaska. The pilots aboard Alaska Airlines Flight 53 reportedly witness enormous, bright, disc-like objects tracking their airplane. Ground control reports that no object is visible on radar, but it is the speed of the UFO craft that alarms the pilots.
Ahead, just underneath our radar, picked up a blip. He's moving about a mile a second. He's pulled out straight ahead of us, just disappeared. Man, he was there and then he was gone.
If you're a pilot and you report a UFO sighting to the FAA, you might as well turn in your license the next day. The FAA, the military, even civilian authorities don't want to know about UFOs.
Pilot encounters with UFOs first surfaced in the 1920s and 30s, long before black box and control tower tape recordings were possible.
Sightings by pilots have occurred ever since the very beginning with Kenneth Arnold.
Kenneth Arnold was flying from Chehalis, Washington, over towards Idaho. Somewhere around Mount Rainier, he identified what looked to him to be about 9 aircraft traveling in an east-to-west position.
It was this man, Kenneth Arnold, from Boise in Idaho, who ushered in the era of the flying saucer.
At this point is where I had this terrific flash. I looked way off here to the north, and that's when I saw where the flash came from. It was an echelon formation of a very peculiar-looking aircraft. The second craft from the rear had a more or less crescent shape, and of course I kept mulling in my mind, that's the damnedest-looking airplane I ever saw.
Upon landing in Yakima, Washington on June 24, 1947, Arnold makes what would become the very first civilian reports of UFOs to the government. He would describe the objects to reporters as appearing and moving like, quote, saucers skipping across the water.
Somebody else twisted that around into the term flying saucer. That was the beginning of it.
His official report made to the Joint Army and Air Force's intelligence is seen here for the first time on television. Arnold describes the UFOs as thin, round in the front, and coming to a point in the back, and did not appear to whirl or spin. He watches as the craft flip and flash in the sun and comments, "The more I observe these objects, the more upset I became, as I am accustomed and familiar with most all objects flying."
The Arnold case was extremely significant in that prior to it, there had been no talk publicly about disc-shaped shiny objects flying around. And we haven't been without UFOs or flying saucers ever since.
Coming up, the skies above New England are rocked by 3 separate UFO encounters, all captured on tape.
Have you got anything flying out in the area?
Negative, 105 turned over.
Well, then I just had a couple of UFO reports.
The Grand Canyon is a graveyard for 128 passengers and crew of 2 airliners which collided in a thunderstorm and crashed on peaks little more than a mile apart. The impact reduced the wreckage to carbonized smears of paint and metal. None survived. It was the worst commercial air disaster in history.
While some experimental black box and pilot voice recorders were in use by the military during World War II, it was not until a catastrophic mid-air collision in 1956, about 200 miles due east of Area 51, that onboard recording boxes were mandated by the FAA.
A major accident above Grand Canyon imposed the FAA and the NTSB to ask for all the airlines to be equipped with audio recording system.
Since the mandate of cockpit voice recorders, hundreds of reports have been made of strange lights, near-miss collisions, and radar tracking of unidentified flying objects. 3 recent pilot recordings captured over New England have been obtained for this broadcast. They are presented here for the first time.
One of the most fascinating cases is Lufthansa 405 out of JFK, November 18th, 1995, where they saw a UFO across Long Island.
November 18, 1995, while on a routine flight above Long Island, New York, Lufthansa Flight 405 and Airbus A340 out of New York en route to Frankfurt, Germany, makes a disturbing call to Boston Air Traffic Control. The pilots report an unidentified flying object passing within 3,000 feet of their plane.
It should be on our tail about 10 minutes. We passed it just 1 minute ago and it was looking strange.
The UFO is described as a long cylindrical object with a white light on the front and a long green comet tail. The strange UFO is also seen by British Airways Flight 226, a 747 flying from London, and is just north of the object. The code name for British Airways flights is Speedbird.
It actually looked at the opposite traffic to those of the above. It did have a very strong vapor trail, which looked more like smoke, and the light on the front was very, very bright.
Lufthansa 405, how far off your side did that traffic pass?
It was pretty close, and like the Speedbird said, it was, looked like 2 or 3,000 feet above on the left wing. First monorail looked like a UFO.
Boston Air Traffic Control contacts Giant Killer, the military fleet area control and surveillance facility that monitors restricted airspace over the Northeast.
Thank you.
Have you got anything flying out in the area?
Negative, 105 turned over.
Well, then I just had a couple of UFO reports.
Is that right?
I had a couple of guys that reported lights just went all over their head. I had no traffic whatsoever in the area. They said it passed within a mile of them, like 2,000 feet above them, opposite direction.
Huh. Well, it could have been a meteor or something. No, we don't have an aircraft out there.
Both pilots confirm the object has glowing lights. The object has a green vapor trail, not like any vapor trail they've ever seen.
Both pilots immediately question the idea that the UFO they saw was a meteor.
That's a 405, so you would say that it definitely wasn't a meteor, right?
I don't know.
It was flying level. It was going very quickly. They were faster than normal aircraft. It was cruising in a straight line at one level flight.
Number 226, thank you. We're looking into it. I mean, we're making a report. We really don't know what it was. And the military doesn't admit to anything flying tonight.
While the authenticity of this recording is not in question, the FAA and both airlines have never commented on this mysterious incident over New England. 2 years later, Boston would be the epicenter of yet another strange encounter between pilots and UFOs. But this time, the encounter would result in a near-miss collision. The incident was captured on tape by the aircraft's black box recorder. August 9th, 1997. Swiss Air Flight 127 is a jumbo jet en route to Zurich, Switzerland. Pilot Philip Bulbet and First Officer Kurt Grunder are at the controls. At 23,000 feet, Bulbet will later report that his visibility was excellent with no haze and a clear blue sky. Until an unidentified craft enters the plane's airspace. The pilot immediately contacts Boston Air Traffic Control.
Swiss Air 127, go ahead.
Yes, sir. I don't know what it was, but it just overflew like a couple of hundred feet above us. I don't know if it was a rocket or whatever, but incredibly fast, opposite direction. It was too fast to be an airplane.
Later in his official report, Bulbet will describe the UFO as a bright white cylindrical object with no wings, similar to a white shark. Aviation writer Don Berliner filed a Freedom of Information Act request to obtain the FAA audio and written records of this incident.
The Swiss Air case is significant because the object that was described is quite unusual, and the people reporting it have excellent credentials. These are veteran airline pilots.
Moments later, the Boston Control Tower contacts another sector operator who is about to take over the flight.
Hey, Chris, that Swiss Air 127, he had a UFO or a rocket, something almost hit him in my airspace.
UFO or a rocket almost hit the Swiss Air 127?
Went right above him, about 300 feet.
The pilot's official incident report classifies the object as a UFO, categorizing its shape, color, and speed. However,
we're about now 3 minutes out of Christchurch Airport, and on our starboard side we can see two very bright lights, one much brighter than the other. It is like a very, very bright star, and just below it is another light, not quite so bright.
Just before midnight, Fogarty goes airborne with New Zealand cargo pilot Bill Startup. The beginning of the flight is uneventful. Then at 12.05 a.m., Fogarty and the crew see strange lights and objects coming toward them from the right side of the plane. Fogarty turns on his camera and begins filming.
Those two lights appear to be traveling with us. They're still off the starboard wing. The brighter light is still above the other, and it's moved a little further ahead of the other. It's extremely bright, much brighter than any of the other stars in the sky.
Ground radar observes these objects, and the control tower confirms the sighting and records the conversation. What follows is the actual audio of this unusually well-documented event.
The storm track is showing at 11 o'clock at 3 miles. Just left at 9 o'clock at 3 miles.
Captain Startup recounts that the object, or target, is initially ahead of him, then travels at an unbelievable speed past his left side. He quickly banks the plane left in an attempt to make visual contact. On the ground, Wellington Air Traffic Control radios a chilling message to the captain. They've picked up yet another target on his left side, and this one is closing in on the plane.
Target is 12 o'clock at 3 miles.
now looking over towards the right of the aircraft, and we have an object confirmed by Wellington radar. It's been following us for quite a while. It's about 4 miles away, and it looks like a very faint star, but then emits a very bright white and green light.
Captain Startup is able to get close enough to determine that the object is an array of bright blue lights pulsing at a rapid rate. To his shock, the object has gotten bigger.
There was an interesting radar event where the some object got so close to the aircraft it looked to Wellington radar as if the aircraft radar target image had doubled in size.
Strong target, right in formation with you now. Your target has doubled in size.
The double-sized target continues to appear on radar screens for 36 seconds, then returns back to normal size.
Yeah, blue light's right there. This is the object which was apparently traveling along with the aircraft. It was picked up on aircraft radar.
Dr. Bruce Maccabee received a 16-millimeter copy of the Argosy UFO film directly from the Australian TV network in 1979.
Roll 4, take 10.
This complete and unedited film has never been made available before. Experts believe that these images are the most comprehensive and frightening UFO evidence ever captured on film.
This is the famous New Zealand film obtained the night of December 31st, 1978. The cameraman is sitting in the seat between the pilot and the co-pilot. The image is dancing around because he was carrying it on his shoulder. They saw this light to their right. And this light, as time goes on, will fade in and out, takes on various shapes. This is the flashing light that you have to slow down and look at frame by frame to see what happens. When it goes from very bright white down to dim orange, you can see the image went over to the side, then he turned the camera a little bit in order to pull it back into the center.
That other target that has been following us has now been joined by two others, so we now, at this stage, have three unidentified flying objects just off our right wing, and they've been following us, or one of them has been following us now for probably about 10 minutes.
And that's the way it is. Or is it? Monday, January 1st, 1979. This is Walter Cronkite, CBS News. Good night.
Coming up, while the Apollo 11 astronauts were the first men to set foot on the moon, they were not the first to make reports of sightings of the unknown in outer space. Pilot sightings of UFOs are not exclusive to Earth's atmosphere. In the early 1960s, as America and the Soviet Union escalate the space race, astronauts and cosmonauts begin to witness strange and unexplained objects and events in outer space.
You know, 1958, when NASA formed, they literally expected to make contact with extraterrestrial life.
December 4th, 1965. 4 hours and 24 minutes into the historic 14-day mission, the astronauts of Gemini 7, Frank Borman and James Lovell, both military test pilots, are performing routine tasks. Then suddenly, at 22:34 Universal Time, as the capsule is high above Hawaii, both men see a bright object, or bogey, flying above their capsule. Borman radios mission control in Houston. What follows are the actual radio transmissions.
Gemini 7, can you hear me?
Last clear. 7, go ahead.
I'm bogey at 10 o'clock high.
This is Houston. Say again, 7.
So we have a bogey at 10 o'clock high.
The recording suddenly ends. NASA insists the sighting is Gemini's Titan booster rocket. Lovell replies that he can see the booster as well as, quote, several actual sightings.
I remember hearing this on my car radio, talked to NASA, and they confirmed that that was the phrase used, we have a bogey in sight.
In NASA's official Gemini 7 mission report, published in January 1966, no mention is ever made of the infamous bogey recording. Neither Lovell nor Borman have ever commented publicly on this message.
But as far as the American public is concerned, NASA denies the very existence of UFOs they've been covering up since the dawn of spaceflight.
From the early years of the space program, NASA was beset with sighting reports from astronauts. September 13, 1966. Gemini 11 astronauts Richard Gordon and Charles Pete Conrad see something strange on their 16th revolution of Earth, 27 hours and 47 minutes after takeoff. Conrad radios ground control. He reports he has just seen an unidentified object about 50 miles downrange. It is metallic and revolving at more than one revolution per second. He then pulls out a camera and snaps three photographs. It drops down in front of them before quickly disappearing. Seen here are the actual photographs taken by Conrad aboard Gemini 11.
And NORAD said that the only thing that they could imagine it was a booster from a Russian satellite. The NASA people threw out the NORAD explanation almost immediately. The Gemini 11 case is the only one that NASA considers to be unidentified.
Gemini 11, however, was not the last NASA mission to have alleged encounters with UFOs. In fact, more and more UFO sightings were reported as Gemini opened the door to the Apollo program.
The Apollo astronauts in particular were trailed by UFOs.
It is alleged that Neil Armstrong, you know, saw UFOs. Many of the astronauts did, but they won't talk about it publicly yet, but they might.
Griffin, Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed.
The famous Apollo 11 mission reportedly experienced objects tracking the capsule, as well as objects that were photographed by the astronauts on the lunar surface. 4 months later, on November 14, 1969, Apollo 12 commander Pete Conrad reports back to NASA that he sees an unidentified object out his window.
An object which is in the same place all the time, but appears to be tumbling. Well, we've had it ever since yesterday. It just seems to be tagging along with us.
While the object is widely considered to be debris falling from the booster, many researchers remain skeptical. They suggest such an object would be incapable of tracking a fast-moving space capsule for an extended period of time. As the Apollo missions open the door to the space shuttle program, experts are convinced the door was also open to an increased level of UFO activity in outer space. In 1981, NASA initiates the Space Shuttle program, and with it, an unprecedented wave of UFO sightings, including astounding audio and video evidence. One highly controversial recording emerges from STS-29, a Space Shuttle Discovery flight on March 13, 1989. Astronaut John Blaha reports the sighting of something unusual.
One of the NASA transmissions that wasn't successfully sanitized. Back in 1989, one of the astronauts on a space shuttle said, "We're still looking at the aliens." It was as plain as day.
The following recording was reportedly intercepted by a ham radio operator in Maryland. To this day, NASA has neither confirmed nor denied the validity of this transmission.
The space shuttle has two radio channels. One is a public channel that we all hear when NASA is broadcasting. We can hear what the astronauts are saying. The other channel is a Department of Defense encrypted channel, and that's where I believe the real conversations are going on.
The new millennium ushered in more UFO sightings by NASA shuttle crews. One extraordinary recording occurred aboard Space Shuttle Flight STS-73. Mission specialist Catherine Coleman sees something curious on day three of the routine 15-day mission.
This is October 21st, 1995.
We have an unidentified flying object.
And nothing after. I mean, there she is. Catherine's just floating around in there. And that's where I believe they went on to the Department of Defense encrypted channel on the space shuttle, and they continued the conversation.
Researcher David Cereda has been studying unusual phenomena in outer space for over a decade. It is his theory that NASA continued recording, but on a secret frequency, leaving us with more questions than answers.
We have an unidentified flying object.
Even recent shuttle missions have had eerie reports and sightings of strange objects. According to Cereda, Some of the most shocking evidence of UFOs in outer space comes as recently as August 6, 2005, from Space Shuttle Flight STS-114.
Well, the space shuttle is doing 18,000 miles an hour around the Earth. So the object is traveling obviously much faster than 18,000 miles an hour to catch up to the shuttle, to fly in tandem speed with it, and then it takes off and goes back out the other way. This is real footage from the space shuttle. Even considering that it may be just a few miles away from the space shuttle, it's obviously a very large UFO.
The object enters quickly, dramatically changes speed and direction, then flies back out of frame. The trajectory and speed of the object defy all laws of physics, leaving researchers like Sereda to draw their own conclusions.
When you zoom in on video frames or any digital media, you get pixelation. So some of the rectangular shapes you see are pixels, but notice also you can see the round aura of light around it. So you can still differentiate shapes within the pixels. There's no way that's dust and debris. There's no way it's another satellite. When you go through process of elimination, you know that what we're seeing in STS-114 is truly a UFO. There's really nothing else out there like that.
Since NASA does not comment on the topic of UFOs, the authenticity of space recordings and sightings cannot be officially confirmed, which leaves many questions unanswered.
UFOs constantly trailed our spaceships around planet Earth, the space shuttle, but more importantly, all the Apollo, the Project Apollo spacecraft on the way to the moon.
I think a lot of astronauts are going to start coming forward and testifying to what they have seen.
My impression is that the guys who go running around saying the NASA stuff proves something are hyping it.
As Earth's airspace grows more and more crowded each day and more people than ever take to the skies, is it possible that reports like the ones you've just seen will continue?
There are reams and reams of official reports by commercial aircraft, by private aircraft, and military aircraft about pilot encounters. Even if, while we're sitting right here in California, a UFO turned up over Santa Monica Bay, you probably hear a great explanation of how it was a reflection of the sun behind the cloud.
So many reports from so many experienced pilots of strange phenomena and frightening encounters with UFOs since the beginning of manned flight. As our pilots fly through Earth's atmosphere and further into space, many continue to wonder, do the skies truly belong to us or to them?
3179, we got a passenger taking a picture of it right now.
Right. Looks like a UFO.
Half a million acres of land, thousands of workers, billions of dollars in development, schools, stores, movie theaters, and still, no one knew it existed. The biggest American secret of all time is now uncovered. Hidden cities dedicated to the race for the first atomic bomb. The Lost Worlds, next on the History Channel.